Dartmouth's Department of Psychiatry has substantial academic strength, and we direct that strength toward the pressing health needs that we find in the community around us. Our efforts in that way really help clinical care locally, and our discoveries and our training influence the care really throughout the country and throughout the globe. In our child psychiatry clinics, our faculty work with young people, transitional age youth, for instance, who have autism, to try to make sure that they can succeed in the workplace and thereby be able to live meaningful adult lives. In our community mental health settings, our faculty are working to design and implement programs that will help people with severe mental illness live longer lives by addressing some of the problems that they can have, including obesity, heart disease, and pulmonary problems. At our affiliated VA, the VA National Center for Post-Traumatic Stress Disorder is at Dartmouth, and that is able to influence the care that we deliver locally and, of course, the care that's delivered nationally. At our state hospital, our faculty working with the staff at the hospital are designing and implementing techniques to try to prevent, certainly manage, the aggression that can occur on inpatient units so that the people who are treated there are able to recover in an environment of safety. Our programs touch lives. A great example of this is how we're able to use our academic strength to address the problem of addiction.
Northern New England is absolutely beautiful, and it's a wonderful place to live. Living in a beautiful spot doesn't protect us from substance use disorders or the suffering that comes along with them. New Hampshire has been struggling a great deal with opioid addiction in particular. Our state has one of the highest rates of opioid overdose deaths in the country. In addition, marijuana is everywhere. A lot of people feel very positively about marijuana, but it's clear that it has some very negative impacts as well. We see those clinically. We want to be able to give people scientifically supported advice about the risks and benefits of marijuana use. And then, of course, alcohol use disorders are everywhere. They're exceedingly common and have an impact on all of our communities. As an academic department here at Dartmouth-Hitchcock, we have the opportunity to take the resources and turn them towards this enormous community problem. Being able to create model clinical care that screens and addresses these serious difficulties. It includes being able to train medical students, residents, fellows, the public on these difficulties so that people can join us in working on them as a community.
I went on to rehab and I was in recovery for about 10 years.
Women who become pregnant who are dealing with substance use disorders, particularly opioid use disorders, are a particular challenge for clinicians to manage, in part because we actually don't really want those women to try to stop using opioids entirely on their own. So we know that most women are not successful in doing this and are very likely to relapse. So we recommend that women who have opioid use disorders are on maintenance treatment during pregnancy. And this requires engaging them in treatment, ideally early on in the pregnancy, and then helping them access treatment, generally either with buprenorphine or methadone, to help keep them stable throughout the pregnancy. We approach that by using an integrated treatment program that provides women obstetric care, psychiatric care, and addiction care all in one place at one time on the same day of the week so that we can ensure that women get all the services that they need. We've had great success in helping women achieve abstinence and be able to care for their infants safely. We've also done a lot of work on the inpatient side with reducing neonatal abstinence syndrome, so reducing the length of time that babies need to be in the hospital, reducing the amount of medication they need, and reducing intensive care nursery admissions for those infants. Most importantly, we feel that we're able to try to break the intergenerational cycles of addiction that many of these families have been part of. We want every medical student who trains here and every resident who trains here to achieve a certain level of basic skill in treating people with substance use disorders. We also make sure that every one of our residents who passes through our program receives training in order to become a buprenorphine provider. We also provide training to our colleagues in obstetrics and gynecology, as well as pediatrics and other fields. half of the women are using marijuana regularly when they come into our treatment program. So we encourage women in our program to be abstinent from marijuana, and we assist them with that. But at the same time, we wouldn't want someone to leave treatment simply because she's not able to achieve that.
For the last 20 years or so, we've been working on improving strategies to help people quit smoking marijuana, those that are having problems with it. The treatment research, what seems to be most promising currently, is a combination of doing behavioral talk therapies and use of incentives. We've yet to identify a medication that is really that promising, but we're getting there. What we've learned about treatment as well is that it can be pretty costly. And so one of the things we've learned is we can use technology to deliver some of the treatment and save money.
We've done a lot of work developing and evaluating a number of different interventions that are designed to help people try to change problematic drug use. So this teaches new skills that can help people understand their patterns of self-defeating drug use, to learn problem-solving skills, to learn social skills and leverage new personal and other resources that can help them to be successful in initiating and maintaining change in drug-taking behavior. What we've found is that we can roughly double abstinence rates from different drugs of abuse when you offer these personalized tools as part of a healthcare model for addiction versus when they're not part of the care model. Unfortunately, we have a significant issue with addiction, not only in our country, but globally, and there's an insufficient workforce to meet the need at scale. And so, given the ubiquity of access to mobile devices, the idea is that we can have scalable, personalized resources that can extend the reach and the impact of our healthcare delivery system. We're doing a multinational implementation project where we're taking an evidence-based digital health tool for mental health and substance use and embedding it in primary care systems all over Colombia and Chile and Peru, and we're evaluating that.
One of the great strengths in the department is the study of addictions. And we're very fortunate as a basic neuroscientist to be able to talk to my colleagues in the department who are clinicians or do clinical research. And what we are able to do is actually take findings that come up in the clinical research and then bring them back into the animal model. So one of the things that we study, for example, is co-occurring schizophrenia and substance use problems. We can look at what happens in the patients that are being studied in the department and then bring that back to the animal models to begin to understand what the mechanistic underpinnings of those disorders are in the animals.
Our Department of Psychiatry is part of a first-class university, Dartmouth College and Dartmouth Geisel School of Medicine, and a first-class health system, Dartmouth Hitchcock. And we are trying as best we can to learn how to deliver psychiatric care. My commitment as a chair is to make sure that what we do and the care we deliver is the best possible care, informed by research, and to ensure that we are able to treat those people who live with us and live near us in New England can benefit from what we are able to do as we influence care locally, nationally, and around the globe.